Today we're going to look at rational functions. Now these are functions which have the form polynomial on the top, polynomial on the bottom, and in particular how we solve them. And there's a tool that we're going to use, and I want to emphasize this is not a calculus tool. It's a purely algebraic tool, and the tool is called partial fractions. A lot of people, when they hear the phrase partial fractions, get flashback to this part of calculus, like, it's a calculus thing. But they really should have the, it's an algebra thing, because it really truly is an algebra thing. And the idea of partial fractions, it's a beautiful idea. It says, if you have this fraction over, a polynomial over polynomial, you can pull things into nice pieces. And it's that process of pulling things apart. That's partial fractions. And you might say, okay, this kind of makes sense. Our general approach to solving problems is pull things into smaller pieces, each piece being much easier to work with. I like the way we're going. Good. And I think you're going to enjoy this one. Let's begin. So, as a reminder, I want to emphasize this. A rational function means it's a polynomial over a polynomial. If you do not have a polynomial over a polynomial, partial fractions can't be done. Now, it doesn't mean it can't be done eventually. It just means it can't be done right now. What you have to do is make a substitution, perhaps, and so that it becomes a polynomial over a polynomial. So just keep in mind, you cannot start partial fractions until polynomial over polynomial. Now, do we have rational functions that we like? The answer is yes. In fact, there's a couple of them. X to a power. We love that. X squared, X to the 10th, X to the 172. You know, we're like, woohoo, we love those. And not far off are 1 over something like X minus A to a power. We can handle that. Even if it's like 1 over X minus A, that's a natural law. If it's 1 over X minus A squared, it's like X minus A to the minus 2. Power rule again. Ha! Cool. The other one we want to mention, it's a little bit more complicated, a little bit more dicey. 1 over X minus A squared plus B squared. And all that raised to the power K. Now, this one you're like, seems a little bit more iffy. But let's point out one special case. 1 over X squared plus 1. That falls into that category. And we love that integral. It brings a little glint to our eye. We're like, cool, 1 over X squared plus 1. Because when we integrate, we get arctangent. What a beautiful function. In general, if you encounter something that looks like this, you say, hey, I can do trig substitution. And it becomes X minus A equals B tangent theta. And so you say, so by using trig substitution, we can handle these types of problems. Great, wonderful. So these are some examples of rational functions we like. Now you might say, great, but there are rational functions we might not like. This is the really cool fact. It's a wonderful thing, it's true, that says, hey, every rational function can be pulled apart as a combination of these three things. Now, you aren't going to have necessarily all three of them simultaneously, but every rational function can be rewritten as a nice way. So that's what partial fractions is. How do you pull things apart? Now, before we get too far into it, I want to point out why we're doing this, because I think there's a really beautiful underlying idea here, which is, you might say the following. It says, well, suppose you had to do the integral of something like, I'll just make up something really quick here, x squared minus x minus 2 dx. Say, well, this looks terrible, right? Because what's happening? Our thing that makes it look terrible, the thing that makes us go, this looks a little bit iffy, is the fact that if you look downstairs, we have all this subtraction going on in the denominator. That's a terrible place to have subtraction going on. We would much prefer to have things going on upstairs. But here's what partial fractions will allow us to say. It says, hey, This is the same as the integral. X squared minus x minus 2 turns out to be x minus 2 times x plus 1. You can check, it's a true statement. And now we can say, aha, downstairs you really have x minus 2 and x plus 1. You can pull it apart. It'll become something over x minus 2 and something over x plus 1. And then, of course, the real trick is, what's the something? And that's the part that you have to think about. And let's see, I believe, well, I'll just put a question mark plus a question mark. We'll get into how you figure these things out. That's really the next step. But what have you done? You've really pulled it apart. And so the moral is that another way to think of partial fractions, how do we simplify addition downstairs? So it's kind of like trig substitution in the spirit of trig substitution says, ooh, the problem with square roots of that sum in the middle, how do you get rid of that plus? Well, by making a trig sub, we were able to condense it. Here it's the same thing. It's like, ooh, there's some addition and subtraction going on downstairs. How do we do that? And it's partial fractions. We pull it apart. So we're learning how to get better at things like adding and subtracting. That's really what's happening here. Okay, so let's talk about the process. How does partial fractions work? We've got to think back to it. You know, it's been a while since we probably did this. So what do we do? Well, first step. If the degree on the top is larger than or equal to the degree on the bottom, do long division. So that says, look, you really want to get to the point where the degree on top is smaller than the degree on the bottom. So that's step one. So in essence, it says, hey, make sure the degree downstairs is larger than the degree upstairs. Now, if you're trying to remember how do you do long division, we can just do a quick example. So suppose you have something like, let's say x cubed plus 1, divide that by x squared plus x. Well, how does that mean? Well, it says we're going to take x squared plus x, divide into x cubed, and 0x squared, and 0x, and 1. So I like to put all the sort of the entries there. And the moral is, look at the leading terms. That's it. If you can remember that principle, what's happening with the leading term, and deal with that, and then update. You're fine. It all works out. So we'll just make ourselves a little note. Look at our leading terms. Well, you might say, what do you mean? Tell me more. Okay, great. Here's what we mean. Say, look, our leading term right now, x squared and x cubed. What do you have to multiply x squared by to get x cubed? The answer is x. Great. So put an x. Now you multiply x by the whole thing, not just the leading term, the whole expression. So that'd be x cubed plus x squared. And you subtract the whole thing off. So essentially you're saying, because I have this x, I've now introduced an x cubed plus x squared if I do the multiplication out. So I need to say, ha, let me update. I have that in there. The x cubed will cancel by design. Then you have minus x squared and a plus 1. Say, okay, great. Now, my new leading term, x squared, new leading term, minus x squared. What do I have to multiply x squared by to get to minus x squared? The answer is minus 1. So, again, that's the next term, minus 1 times everything. Minus x squared minus x, subtract, and we end up, the minus x squareds cancel, you get an x plus 1, and now we stop because the power has dropped down. So what do we conclude? Well, we conclude it's equal to x minus 1, this part up here, plus our x plus 1 over x squared plus x. All right, so that's what we mean by long division. Now, in essence, remember we said we love three types of rational functions? So the first type of rational function we said was, hey, x to a power. And that's what's coming out if you have to do long division. You get x to the power. Now we have to deal with the other kinds of rational functions we get. All right, so step two. How do we pull things apart? Well, we use partial fractions. So what you do is you say, all right, look in your denominator. And every polynomial can always be factored, though not easily, but still, it's true, can be factored as things that look like x minus the number, which can also be x plus the number if you like, just depends, and irreducible quadratic terms, which if you do completing the squares, are things that look like x minus a squared plus b squared. Okay, so we say, great, we factor it out. Now, for example, in this case, x squared plus x factors as x times x plus 1. It's possible you get repeated roots. So you might have like x to the fifth downstairs. That's perfectly fine. It's possible. Now, what's going to happen is we form a, well, okay, for lack of a better word, you have a form. You have a mold to put things into. And you say, all right, now what I want to do is I want to pull things apart. So if I see an x minus a to the power r downstairs, I say, okay, when I'm pulling things apart, what I'm going to need is I'm going to need an x minus a, an x minus a squared, all the way up to an x minus a to the r. That will show up in my expression. And then there's other pieces. And these a1, a2, up through ar are constants. They're constants to be determined. If you have an irreducible quadratic, okay, then the irreducible quadratic, again, if it's to some power, then you work your way up. So you have the irreducible quadratic to the first, to the second, so forth and so on, up to the rth power. And this is, of course, where it gets a little bit interesting. When it's just a linear term, that x minus a, you have constants in your numerators. When it's an irreducible quadratic term, you'll have linear terms. So some number times x plus a number for, you know, to the first power, some number times x plus number to the second power for the second power, and so forth and so on. And so, in other words, we're going to pull things apart. So in this case, as an example, you still have the x minus 1 from your long division. Then here, see how you have an x times x plus 1? It'll be something over x and something over x plus 1. So I'll just put a number here, a and b. And so it says, partial fraction says, I can pull it apart like that. For the correct choice of a and b, we don't get to pick a and b have to be determined. So the last part, which really, this when I say the last part of partial fractions is we have to solve for these constants. This is where things get fun. Well, so what do? The answer is, well, there's a couple ways. Okay. So this just, I want to just point out what's going on here. We have to determine them. There are, generally speaking, two approaches. And this is best seen by example, so we're going to do these in the examples. And so I strongly encourage you to go do the practice and walk through the examples. And what you get is you say, well, look, I know I have this pulled out expression equals my original expression. Clear your denominators. So you multiply by the same denominator on both sides so that what happens is you no longer have a denominator at all. What you do have is a polynomial equals a polynomial. So you could say, okay, well, one of the polynomials is what you started with, the very first expression. The other polynomial is, you know, it'll have these unknowns, these A, B, C, whatever you're calling your variables, you know, to be determined. That'll be showing up. So there are two general approaches. And depending upon which one you like, you do go with which one you want. So the first one, oftentimes I think lots of books like this, they say, since I have polynomial equals a polynomial, that says if I look at every single coefficient, so I look at the coefficient of the constant term, the coefficient of x squared, that has to match the constant term, the coefficient of x squared, and so forth and so on. So we get a lot of equations. So we get a system of equations, and we say, perfect. Now I have several equations, several unknowns, and I can solve, and life is good. That works perfectly fine. I like to also supplement it with the following. In fact, it's probably my preferred method when we can use it, which says, look, I have a polynomial equal to a polynomial. So that says they have to be equal for all possible choice of x. So we must choose, but choose wisely. For as a good choice brings us closer to an answer, a wrong choice will bring us further from it. So of course you might say, well, what do you mean by choose wisely? Well, hint, we love zero. So look at it and say, is there anything that makes things zero? Are almost everything zero except maybe one term which has one of these things we're trying to figure out? Because if there is, plug in that value for x, and life is good. It can speed up the solution. Now, I would strongly encourage you to use number two as much as possible and to supplement when needed. So ideally, know how to do both. And as we go through and do problems, you'll see that we jump around. Really what you have in partial fractions is, let's just go through the procedure. We start and we say, rational function, polynomial over polynomial, do long division if needed, that's step one. Use partial fractions to rewrite. And so go back to our algebra. This is all algebra today. You know, it's like, hey, we did this stuff before. We can do it again. We are capable. And that's solving for the coefficients. And it's going to be a lot of fun. It's going to feel a little awkward at first. We're like, but once you get a couple of them underneath our belts, we'll be like, okay, this is not so bad. The key thing, there's two key things. One, figuring out what the right form is. And there's simple rules and a little bit of practice, and it just pops out. And the second thing is learning how to solve for the constants showing up in the numerators of our pulled out form. And again, use the two ideas. Choose wisely. Also, look for setting coefficients equal. Okay, good. And that's really what it says in three here. That's the idea. Well, but in terms of integration, what happens after you've pulled it apart, after you've solved for your constants, what you've done is you've rewritten the expression. There has been no calculus done. No calculus at all. Everything that's been done is algebra to rewrite it, but what's there, the part that's left over, is something that can now be easily done. In other words, these are nice integral problems, the kind of integral problems we're willing to take home to meet the family. All right, I think this is probably one of the things that really, above anything else, it pays to see examples. Once you see it, it'll all come back, one way or another. Maybe you'll have some flashbacks, or maybe you'll have some happy memories, I don't know. But whatever it does, let's begin. Let's go and do some practice.